Truth is, I thought it mattered. I thought that
money
mattered. But does it bollocks? Not compared to how people matter.
Welcome, mention and other fine folks, to the Sunday Dispatch of the Black Letter, where we contemplate thoughts worth thinking as we try to create better lives for ourselves as we finagle our way through the upside-down, topsy-turvy world we find ourselves in. So here we go. We've got a few things on the agenda. Just kind of take a cursory look at a whole bunch of different things about the economy and, of course, cryptocurrencies doing well and other things of that nature. See where the stock markets are at rather than doing a deep dive today. So first up, Florida sets death toll record while trailer truck outside funeral home raises COVID-19 fears. Florida set another record Tuesday with nearly 200 more COVID-19 deaths recorded overnight. But in recent days, an ominous sight outside a funeral home has been sending a shiver through a Miami area town, a refrigerated trailer for storing bodies. Of course, there's a picture of it. There's a bunch of trailers, actually. Hialeah Mayor Carlos Hernandez acknowledged remains were being stored in the trailer. So folks, this goes to show you how serious things are. We're still in the first wave. In fact, I was reading an article that suggests the World Health Organization considers this virus unique. Perhaps this is just going to be one continuous wave. But anyway, the United States is still struggling with this first wave and is winning, of course, making the virus great again. So please be careful out there, stay healthy, and listen to the experts. They do have your best interest in heart. So if they advise wearing masks, that's what I would certainly do. In fact, the city I'm at here in Canada, I think, has mandated masks starting next week sometime in all indoor public places. So that's something I'm going to have to get used to. I don't particularly care to wear them. I don't like them. But of course, we need to protect each other and ourselves as well. So please take it seriously out there, folks. Stay healthy and stay well. We've seen the Northman Trader a bunch of times, and he's always got something good worth reading about. On the 23rd of July, he spoke about the Super Bowl. Markets have been bloated to high heaven by unlimited and unprecedented liquidity injections, creating the illusion of a bull market when there is none. Equal weight keeps lagging. You can see here that's the equal weighted. It's not at its all-time high, whereas the top FANG stocks in them at 20% or so is, of course, making almost new highs here. Virtually all market gains are driven by a handful of stocks, as you can see down here. The five largest stocks have returned 35% year to date. The other 495 stocks have declined by 5%. So Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, and Google are making all-time highs. They're up 35% on the year, I believe. The S&P 500, well, yeah, it's up 2% on the year, you can see. And the remaining 495 companies are still yet to recover. So obviously, this is a bifurcated market for some reason. Well, I think the reason is obvious. It's a stimulus-driven market, primarily. There's no fundamentals underlying all of this. In fact, the broader market has gone nowhere since mid-April, and you can see that it's been pretty much stagnant since around mid-April, barely moving at all. And of course, the total market cap to GDP ratio is currently at 155.3. Well, I don't think we've ever seen this this high at all. It's just astonishing. And PE levels are at another extreme. We'll open this up. You can see here a 28.16 PE ratio for the S&P 500. Just madness. There's no way to tell if betting on ostensibly cheap companies will work again. This is what BlackRock's senior quant had to say. He thinks that the days of value investing are over. This is a more complex market and blah, 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 all sorts of nonsense to try and persuade themselves and us that this market is just legitimate and rational, when in fact it's not, of course. You should know that if you've been looking at the market for any length of time, as of course, it's different this time, don't you know? That's the old age argument, that it's different this time, it's more complex, we have more stimulus, or blah, blah, blah. Eventually, reality will catch up with us. It may be argued that entire unlimited quantitative easing and M1 money supply expansion game has had one key net effect: to kill the dollar. The correlation since the March lows seems pretty self-evident. Here you can see the US dollar has been declining as the S&P 500 has been increasing, so that could explain some of the increases for the market. Currency destruction may make a bull market on paper, but in terms of purchasing power, it creates nothing. It's not only stocks that are on trend charts, but also currencies. He's suggesting that the dollar could end up moving upwards in this trend channel, and in which case, of course, equities arguably could come down. So that's a look from the Northman Trader. It's very interesting. Follow him on Twitter. Definitely worthwhile. Recommend that if you're interested in the markets. I think he has a keen and reasoned eye. the coronavirus cryptocurrency craze. Who's behind the Bitcoin buying binge? As you know, Bitcoin has been doing very well lately. Trading of Bitcoin, Ethereum, and other cryptocurrencies increased sharply at the beginning of 2020. You can see here in January, it went up. February, of course, March, April, May stayed high. June's come down a little bit. I think we're going to start seeing more interest now that Bitcoin's taken off in July, August here. If historical growth rates can be maintained, Bitcoin's current daily volume would need fewer than 4 years of growth to exceed daily volume of all U.S. equities and fewer than 5 years to exceed daily volume of all U.S. bonds. Now, off the top of my head, I don't happen to know what the daily volume of bonds or equities is, but it's got to be, I would think, in the tens, hundreds of billions of dollars. So, this shows you the potential here for Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies generally. 15% of American adults now own some form of cryptocurrency, and they own roughly $4,000 per person. These are the newly invested ones. Those who have had cryptocurrencies prior to this year have about $7,000 per person. At 15% penetration, the U.S. cracks the top 10 countries with the highest adoption of cryptocurrencies, which is a good sign because I think cryptocurrencies are going to be an important part in the financial technology sector in the growing decades to come. So it's good to see that a Western democracy is leading the charge here. Many of these other countries, Turkey, Brazil, Colombia, Argentina, South Africa, they're all democratic as well. Mexico too, China's not, Indonesia I don't know about, but still it's good to see. Then the demographics of Bitcoin buyers was interesting. So who fueled this Bitcoin buying binge? High income, well-educated men generally. Millennials and Gen Xers, I'm part of the Gen X demographic group, and Bank of America customers, interestingly. 44% of Americans who have already invested in Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies said that their financial health is much better since the beginning of the COVID crisis. That's in contrast to just 5% of all other U.S. consumers. And of course, that's because we know that Bitcoin particularly has been the best performing asset of the last decade. And of course, now it's doing well and it's holding its store of value as you would expect from sort of digital gold. So it gives us some comfort in knowing that inflation comes, we will have some protection depending on how much of Bitcoin in that we have. Also, interestingly, Apple card holders only comprise 5% of all credit card customers, but among those that do have the card, 47% own some form of cryptocurrency. The surge in cryptocurrency investing has been a boon for Square. Bitcoin revenue for its Cash App for quarter one 2020 was $306 million, up from $65 million in 2019. That's almost a five-fold increase, right? And there's some good news out of the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. The OCC letter clarifies that national banks have the authority to provide fiat bank accounts and cryptocurrency custodial services to cryptocurrency businesses. You might have heard about that, so that's good news. And then talks about some of the crypto-friendly banks that are out there. So very interesting article, all links in the description below. Some good stuff happening in the cryptocurrency realm, that's for sure. Ripple exec unveils P2P payments platform using XRP. A Ripple executive has unveiled a payments platform based on XRP that will work in popular web browsers. Anyone can use it, says Craig DeWitt, to purchase physical goods online using the XRP cryptocurrency. Payburner, a personal project of DeWitt's, is a non-custodial XRP wallet designed to operate as a plugin with the Chrome and Brave web browsers. The beta version built on an earlier Payburner plugin by integrating PayID, an identifier for payments used by entities such as banks. So there's stuff happening, folks, in the cryptocurrency space, and I think in these next coming years, these next 5 to 10 years, this is going to probably change the way finance is done and banking is done in a huge way. I'm certain of it. Again, this is just my own opinion. None of it's financial advice. Just thoughts of what I'm doing and how I'm seeing the world. Ripple XRP explains how crypto is more crucial in a post-pandemic world. Another interesting article. Senior Vice President of Product Ashish Birla said real-time payments are more important than ever. Birla noted that interest and demand in digital payment services are escalating. And of course, we've seen this. I hardly am using cash anymore. Of course, there's pros and cons to that, but Ripple is well positioned to make use of this new change. Much of the demand for instant payments can be attributed to the swiftness of data availability in today's world. He said, the demand and fervor to shift to real-time payments among consumers are real. You don't need to look any further than the fact that payments via mobile wallets now outpace credit card transactions in countries like Thailand, Vietnam, and Indonesia. And it's coming to a crypto wallet near you as well in the Western world, that is for certain. Birla said RippleNet transactions take a mere 3 seconds. At the center of these is XRP. So there's definitely a bullish case for XRP, for Ripple. I think they're going to do well. At least that's my thesis. We'll see. We'll find out eventually. As you know, I think by the end of the decade, Ripple could be a $1,000 coin, but who knows? It's just my opinion, and maybe I'm smoking too much opium. Digital bank Revolut adding support for Stellar. So this is a mixed good news, bad news situation. I'll show you why. So first of all, Revolut is a small UK-based digital bank and has announced that it plans to add support for holding and trading Stellar to its mobile app, which is terrific. I think it's available in UK, might be available in some other places. You can have a look at it, of course, if you're interested. Just a small bank, online only, I think, digital only. But unfortunately, talks about here, unfortunately, we're not able to support external transfers right now due to strict regulation. We totally appreciate that this may be a deal breaker for some people, but we're not ruling out this option for the future. So that's a bit of a ripple in the ripple, if you will, in the cryptocurrencies. I really want to have custodial authority over all my currency, regardless of whether it's crypto or fiat. And if I can move fiat currency around to anywhere, from one bank to another, I should be able to move cryptocurrency from one banking wallet app to another wallet app. So this is a deal breaker for me, but at least they are starting to incorporate more cryptocurrencies. So this is good news overall. But just be aware of that, folks. Still the early days, still the Wild West. Crises like the pandemic don't make people less optimistic. And in case you were just wondering and thinking that the Black Ladder is just a pessimistic vlog, that's certainly not the case. We just live in very difficult times right now, so we need to be realistic about what really is happening. I remain extremely bullish about the future, and I think there's great potential for us, especially now. As some others have said, there's going to be a great wealth transfer in the coming years, I think, unfortunately. And I think you can get aboard that train by investing in precious metals and cryptocurrencies currently, even as they start taking off. I think dollar cost averaging is a good idea. That's what I'm doing. Of course, none of this financial advice. You do you and I'll do me. I'm just offering my thoughts. I'd love to hear your thoughts down below. But anyway, I am an optimistic person by nature, but of course, we're in very dire straits right now. And I think we need to look at that with a realistic lens rather than through hopium, which is what the newspapers and our banksters and government gangsters seem to be trying to manipulate us into believing. Anyway, so here's a good news article. One of the most startling things about people is the way they always think things are going to get better. It doesn't matter how ugly things get, humans are incurable optimists. People become increasingly optimistic between the ages of 15 and 70, and despite popular belief, it has little to do with their life circumstances, which means that you don't have to be rich or poor, healthy or unhealthy. Generally, we like to see the future as being more hopeful than the past. And I agree with that. That's definitely how I see it. And what I'm trying to share here is to share options and realistic looks at the current market and the situation we find ourselves in so that we can make better decisions so that we can enjoy that optimistic and hopeful and abundant future that I'm sure is to come. In the meantime, the next year to three, we're going to have some difficulties. So let's be prepared. All right, just a quick overview of some of the articles that have been interesting to me. I'm going to keep this one a little bit shorter. Let's take a look at the markets. Okay, so in the green so far, NASDAQ in the green 1%, of course, because we're having some earnings. So there's probably been some maybe good earnings. And of course, all these earnings are beating because everything's been so depressed. I think the analysts' earnings analysis has been quite dour, as we've mentioned. So I think it's quite early. I think the bars that they've laid in front of these companies are quite easy to step over. But we'll see how long this continues. Early days, these things can change. Sometimes the morning is not indicative of what the afternoon does. Okay, let's take a look at gold. So gold is taking a pause that refreshes, as you can see here, down just a smidgen, but still up almost 28% on year to date, which is great news. And of course, we expect gold and silver to take a breather now and then, as we would with cryptocurrencies, as we would with the stock markets, except they're not tethered to reality at the moment. And of course, silver, like gold's younger sibling, is also taking a small pause, but still up over 35% year to date, almost coming on 36%. So that's good news. And onto cryptocurrencies, of course, still going up, 332 billion market cap, 7,728 coins. I think that's stabilizing. Bitcoin up only 0.7% so far. So you can see it's starting to take a bit of a break, maybe consolidate a bit. Same with Ethereum. XRP is up 7%, still doing quite well. Some of the others up generally a little bit over here. Stellar up 3.4%. You'd expect that. It's been down for a little while, so that's good news. Almost 4% on Tron. And there you have it. Dash up 6%. Okay, so things are looking pretty good. And onto the online oracle, the 8-Ball Economist, for today's most pressing question. So seeing as we're just taking a look at gold and silver, and they're taking a bit of a break right now, perhaps catch their breath from that dizzying climb up the mountain face. I wanted to ask the online oracle, will silver reach $30 an ounce by the end of the year? I have no idea. I think it could. It might not. Eventually, it'll be well over that. Ask again later. Okay, well, if it's doing that, I'm going to ask it again. So now is later, right? Ask again later. Okay, it doesn't want to tell me. So I think $30 by the end of the year, perhaps. Who knows? At the very least, I think we could see three digits, perhaps within 1 to 3 years. That is to say, I think silver is on its way to $100 an ounce at a minimum, when we really get a sense of how catastrophic the economy really is at the moment. There you have it, folks. Thanks so much for joining me. I appreciate you and spending the time here. I appreciate your comments and discussion below as we try to help each other out, build better lives, stay healthy and wealthy and wise, of course, it's important. And kind. Kindness is the key. It's the oil that helps move the machine. So let's remember to be kind out there, stay healthy. Of course, pay down some debt, squirrel away some money, put some savings away. I think that's important. We're still in uncharted waters. And things could get a little worse before they get better, I believe. But remember, remain hopeful. And as I always say in the outro, dum spiro, spero.